Good morning.
Good morning.
A beautiful day outside as the seasons are changing. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Anybody turn your heat on yet?
Oh, yeah.
Well, we welcome you back into the house of God and pray this morning as we come together, as we open our hearts and our minds to the Word of God, that God continues to teach us.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
It is hard to believe that a whole year has passed since the last time I was up here for NGA. Yeah. They sure go quick, don't they?
Yeah.
First off, I want to thank Eleanor for collecting the pennies. And as she said, we have $145. Wow. This year, we collected 3,596 items for NGA. And I want to thank the Lydia Havlin Circle and Jane and Pat for coming to help sort those items. It is not an easy task. It's time-consuming and tiring. But they are all downstairs, and I'll tell you a little more about that in a few minutes. This year, those items will be handed out to 8 different agencies within the Trenton area. And I'm going to tell you what those agencies are and the number of people that they service throughout the year. Anchor House Incorporated saw over 4,917 people this year. Trenton Psychiatric, 295. Now that was just men and women. Capital Health Foundation, men, boys, women, girls, and infants, 2,050 people. Children's Futures, which is just infants, 313. Children's Home Society, men, women, and infants, 45. Mill Hill, men, boys, women, girls, and infants, 109. Mount Carmel Guild, which is all of them again, 1,025. And United Progress, which is all of them, 725 people. That is the number in the Trenton area that are in need that we know of. How many more people do you think are out there that don't know about this organization and that don't get the wonderful help that we give? Most of you know that over the year we collect all kinds of clothes, new, and toiletries. And on Tuesday, you are all invited at 9 o'clock to come and sort out our 3,596 plus way more than that. They will be sorted out and divided among the agencies. That is from 9, we're saying hopefully 12, but if you could spare 15 minutes, 2 hours, it would be appreciated. Then on Wednesday, we would love to see you come back at 1 o'clock for what is called our NGA, well, we used to be called a T. It's the in-gathering. And at that time, we will hear from the different agencies, the work that they do. And then they will take all of these items, if anybody can help with that, they will take them back and they will be donated to these people throughout the year. The money that we collect, the pennies, that doesn't stop today or this week. These needs go on all year long. Eileen came to me this year, and there was a cry from one of the agencies. They needed diapers. So we donated diapers in the middle of the winter, which at that time we're not all in NGA mode. We're not thinking about it. But these needs go on and on. And the money that we give and the things that we bring in help to throughout the year. I just want to read to you. This is from the Children's Home Society. This is some of the work that they do. The Children's Home Society of New Jersey was opened as New Jersey's first orphanage in 1894 and has evolved into a nationally recognized child welfare and social service nonprofit organization with health, education, counseling, and support services across the state, but with a special focus in Trenton and Central Jersey. So as you can see from that, it's not just the items. They're there to help people. They support them. We all know that in this day and age, people need mental support, social support, everything. And that's what NGA does. And I am so proud to be part of that. And that all of us here can help in any way, whether it's your prayers, your thoughts, or just one item that you buy. There are some of us here, Bonnie, Eileen, I don't think they can walk into a store, and if they see a sale, they don't go right over there and buy things. It is amazing what people do in this church, and I thank each and every one of you for that. And at this time now, if you'll bow your heads, and we will pray for NGA that they can continue this work and it can go on and on to help all of these people that are in need. Dear Father of all mercies, we are clothed, we are fed, we are sound in mind and body. In gratitude for these great blessings, we offer material things for those less fortunate. Add thy blessings, we beseech thee, to the work of our hands and hearts, so that each garment may carry to the wearer not only decency and warmth, but courage, comfort, and hope for brighter days. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Once again, thank you, everyone.
Our Old Testament reading for today is from Psalm 66, verses 1 through 12. Shout with joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Make his praise glorious. Say to God, how awesome are your deeds. So great is your power that your enemies cringe before you. All the earth bows down to you. They sing praise to you. They sing praise to your name. Come and see what God has done. How awesome his works in man's behalf. He turned the sea into dry land. They passed through the waters on foot. Come, let us rejoice in him. He rules forever by his power. His eyes watch the nations. Let not the rebellious rise up against him. Praise our God, O peoples. Let the sound of his praise be heard. He has preserved our lives and kept our feet from slipping. For you, O God, tested us. You refined us like silver. You brought us into prison and laid burdens on our backs. Let men ride over our heads. We went through fire and water, but you brought us to a place of abundance. Amen.
As we come to our time of prayer this morning, an update on Harbor, for those of you that were on the prayer chain, she made out okay with her testing, came home, spiked a fever, ended up in the ER, and she has pneumonia.
Oh.
So continued prayers for Harbor and for Mom and Grandmom.
Yeah.
We're very weary in all of this. Oh. Also, prayers for the Tams family. I have a graveside funeral on Thursday. It was a classmate. Prayers as we gather to celebrate her life and to put her to rest. Our Heavenly Father, we look to you this day with gratitude for each and every blessing that you have poured into our lives. Lord, we realize how fortunate we are, each and every blessing that comes from you. We rejoice in the changing of the seasons, O God, and see you in the color of the leaves and in the sunsets. Lord, it just makes us, it gives us a reminder of just the power that you have had in creating our world. This day, O God, we pray for Harbor and Victoria and Ginger. Lord, we ask that you would be the healing that takes place, for the healing that would take place for Harbor. Lord, she has so many issues, and we just pray that you would enable them to fight this pneumonia and that she can return to the joyful self that she is as a three-year-old. Lord, we just thank you that there are many specialists in her life that are watching her health closely. We lift up the Tams family as we celebrate on Thursday her life and gather to inter her remains. Lord, you know the entire situation, Lord, so I just pray that you would be with me to guard my words, that you would be with her family that is gathered and friends, that we, oh God, can make sense out of this whole situation. So Lord, I ask for your wisdom for Thursday. We pray for traveling mercies for Lily and Andrew as they return from celebrating weddings of classmates and friends. Lord, we also pray for our college students who will be coming home for break very soon. Lord, it seems like they just left. But Lord, be with them and give them safe travel as they return home to their families for a short break. We pray for Betty, Ellen Beth's sister, my sister-in-law's mother, who's recovering from pneumonia. Lord, so many are sick this day, and we pray, oh God, that you would provide the healing, Lord. Give them patience. Help them, oh God, listen to doctors and those that are caring for them, Lord, because you know we are stubborn people. So, Lord, we pray that you would speak into each and every situation. Lord, we pray that you would continue to speak to us as well as your disciples, that you would enable us to do what needs to be done in this area, Lord, and to reach out as well. We continue to reach out to the people who have been affected by the hurricane, Lord. So much has been lost, and yet so many people have so many blessings as well. But Lord, we pray for safety for all those coming to help. Lord, we pray for safety for all those that are still living in those damaged areas as well. So Lord, send your helpers at the right time for each and every situation. Lord, we continue to lift up this service, Lord. Teach us from your word. For we pray all of this in the precious name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Amen. Guys, you want to come up today? Where's Octavia?
Here.
We have a little one. But will she come up or no? For the children's message? You want to come up? Octavia, grab the microphone on the seat. Eileen, show her, please. No? Thank you. You want to scoot down? Here you go. Want to sit here? What'd you bring with you? Oh my goodness. Tell everybody what it is.
It's a Bible.
She got a Bible. My first hands-on Bible. That's so cool. You like it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Today's a tough subject. You have your thinking caps on? Joey, I'm going to start with you. Tell me what manners are.
Manners are something you do, like, to respect someone or something.
Very good.
Very nice. I couldn't come up with
that. That's a good start. Now, tell me an example of a manner. A good manner.
Like wear shoes when you eat, maybe?
Wear shoes when you eat.
I like that one.
That's okay. All right. You have...
My grandpa.
Don't laugh at him. Go ahead, explain it.
My great-grandma told me that one.
There you go. You're laughing at Marion. Can you think of another one? Do you know what a manner is, little girl?
Thank you.
Saying thank you. That's a great one. What else?
Saying please.
Saying please.
Maybe chewing with your mouth closed.
Chewing with your mouth closed. I know great grandma told you that one. Right? What other examples can we give of good manners?
Saying sorry.
Saying you're sorry. Everybody agrees. Something else.
I'm thinking.
Do you know what a good manner is besides saying thank you?
Saying please.
Saying please. They're all good examples. And the more we use them, what do you think that tells people about us?
That we're nice and respectful.
Nice and respectful. And what happens if you don't use good manners, especially around great grandma?
They'll be mad.
They'll be mad. You'll get told about it, won't you?
Yeah.
You probably have to
sit in the corner for hours. You don't use good manners. What happens in school if you talk out of turn?
Principals or out in the hallway.
Are you familiar with the principal's office?
Yes.
He's honest.
Very much so. What else?
Maybe if you don't respect your teacher, and you're sitting with someone else, she'll ask you to go in the hallway and do all your work. Does that happen to my friend Jackson?
Go in the hallway and do your work. Has anybody, now I know that you're all out of school for a long time. Anybody been told that you talk too much? Of course, most of us did that, right? And what happened to us?
Stood in the corner.
Stood in the corner.
Put your head down on the desk.
Put your head down on the desk.
Stayed after school.
Kneeled on corn. Getting old.
Had to hold the Webster's Red Dictionary.
Had to hold the dictionary out.
I still remember his name, though.
Did you ever have your seat moved?
Yes. Had to learn a poem.
All different kinds of things, huh?
Every day my seat's moved.
Cecilia said every day her seat is moved. She talks a lot. Well, if we can remember to have good manners, you'll find out that many people will show those good manners back to you. If you remember to say thank you, you're probably going to get something the next time around, right? If you say please, sure.
Excuse me works also.
Excuse me, go say it again.
Excuse me.
Excuse me works also, right?
Maybe telling the truth is respect too. Telling the truth is respect too.
Telling the truth is respect too. You know, one Sunday these kids are going to have the whole message, okay? Their children's message. So, but today we're going to talk about with the adults. You're going to listen too about why it's important to continue to say thank you. Okay? So remember good manners. Can you do that?
Yeah.
Good girl. They are so much more entertaining than I am.
April, views on the videos are always higher on the weeks when there's a trend. So, sorry.
I'm not upset with that. It's okay. Now we're going to start coughing, right?
Yeah, of course.
I just had a cough drop. This morning, our gospel lesson comes from Luke chapter 17, beginning with verse 11. Listen as Jesus interacts with some people in need. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When Jesus saw them, he said, "Go show yourselves to the priest." And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to give praise to God except a foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Rise and go. Your faith has made you well." May these words remind us and encourage us today. I have to say it again, even if you're tired of hearing it, that this is one of my favorite Bible verses. Now, I know I say that a lot, but the lesson here is one that can really help us when we have one of those days. It's no surprise that Jesus is in the healing business. Countless accounts throughout Scripture document times that he healed those with infirmities, all ages, all genders, all nationalities. Jesus did not discriminate. Where there was a need, he took care of it. Sometimes he made the ones who were asking for healing do something. Other times, he just healed them. Sometimes they didn't have to do anything to be healed at all. It was just Jesus' words that healed them. Sometimes Jesus used things to heal, like when he used mud and spit on the eyes of the blind man. Other times, he required that the one who needed healing follow his directions. And this is a case where he heals the leper. He says, "Go show yourself to the temple priest." And they all did. Anyone who had been considered sick or considered unclean had to prove that they were healed by showing themselves to the priest. So the 10 lepers followed Jesus' command. And as they headed to the temple to show themselves, they were healed. Take notice that Jesus never touched them. Can you say miracle here? Yeah. But the lesson doesn't end there. This is yet another example that there doesn't need to be a touch from Jesus. Jesus was the master of miracles, and his words were enough. But let's go on. 10 men healed, God bless you. And only one, a Samaritan, returns to thank Jesus. He just doesn't say thanks. He throws himself at Jesus' feet, thanking him for the restoration of not only his health, but of his life. For we know that when you contracted leprosy, people with the lepers were separated from their families. They were separated from society. They could not work. They could not be a part of the community at all. They were isolated. They were humiliated. For when anyone came near them, they had to yell out, "Unclean, unclean," so as to warn others of their condition. So do you think it's strange that this is one of my favorite scriptures? Let me explain. Jesus
had a return of 1 in 10. 1 in 10 thanked him for what was done. When we do good for others, we need to remember that we will not always get a thank you. Jesus got 1 out of 10. Should we expect any more? Sometimes we get frustrated when we do acts of kindness that we believe changes people's lives, even if it's for a short period of time, and we seldom get thanks. We send White Cross items to mission sites. We donate to institutions, to colleges, to youth centers. And sometimes we don't hear a word back from them. We get frustrated. We get irritated. And sometimes we even stop giving because we assume it wasn't appreciated. Let me ask you, did Jesus stop healing because only one man returned thanks to him? We need to learn from that. Secondly, the one who returned to give thanks to Jesus was a Samaritan. We should all remember that the Samaritans were not a liked group of people. They were looked down upon. They were not respected. Yet this was the only man who returned to praise God and to give thanks. It should remind us all of the account of the Good Samaritan. Remember that story? As well as the Samaritan woman at Jacob's well. The most unlikely, according to society, and yet they are the ones who had the best manners. We just never know when we reach out to others who will appreciate and acknowledge the effort. We shouldn't be looking for the thank you anyway, but it will always come from the least expected place. Thirdly, the most powerful word is spoken at the end of this passage. Jesus says, "Rise and go forth. Your faith has made you well." Jesus doesn't even take credit for the healing. He says that the man's faith is what has healed him. Now we know that it was faith that Jesus would heal him, and that happened. But the lesson for me is that sometimes we ask God for things and we don't have the faith to allow it to happen. We have to remember that God knows our hearts, and when we approach him with pure faith, we will sometimes not see the results. Now, I know that sometimes all the faith in the world will not change situations. But when that happens, we need to know that it was not to be. God knows more, understands more, sees more, and best of all, God always has our best in mind. Yet we need to trust God to know what is best for us. In one of my devotionals, I read the following quote: "What if when we wake up tomorrow, we only had those things that we gave thanks for?" Does that make you think? Mm-hmm. Made me think. We live in a land of plenty. Most of us, if not all of us, have a place to lay our heads at night. And although we probably still have some wants, we don't have many needs. So today, be the one who will return to Jesus and give thanks. A thankful heart is a heart that is also filled with much faith. Let that be you. Amen. Just a reminder that you need to clear out stuff on the pews. Last Sunday was Communion Sunday, and I'm sure somebody's going to find a communion cup. So let's continue to tidy up in preparation for our church anniversary. Let us leave this day being thankful people. Let us remember that God has blessed us with abundance. Let us give thanks and know that he will continue to be our guide, to be our support, and to be our direction as long as we trust in him. Go in that peace this day. In his name, amen.